Okay, thank you, and welcome to the seventh meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies this morning. First agenda item is to agree to take item 3, which is consideration of today's evidence in private. Are we agreed? That is agreed. Thank you. Second item on our agenda is to hear from stakeholders regarding access to justice in Scotland. So we hear from Jim Stevenson, Convener Access to Justice Committee at the Law Society of Scotland, Jen Ang, Director Just Right Scotland, Fiona McPhail, Principal Solicitor at Shelter Scotland, Rachel Moon, Senior Solicitor and Legal Service Manager at Govan Hill Law Centre, and Colin Lancaster, Chief Executive, Scottish Legal Aid Board, and Gillian Fife, Strategic Lead of the Strong Communities Citizens Advice Scotland, who is joining us remotely. You're all very welcome. And we've chosen a round table format today in order to encourage a little bit more of an informal discussion around the issues. So please feel free to indicate and come in on any of the issues that are of interest to you. So the committee is really keen to hear about how you're currently supporting people seeking advice, the challenges your services are facing, and access to funding. The committee is also interested in hearing your views on legal aid reform. So I could first of all ask each of you to introduce yourself, say a little bit about the work that your organisation does, and maybe a little bit about whether there has been a change to that work as a result of the pandemic and the cost of living crisis. So I'm just going to go in clockwork fashion, starting with Jim Stevenson, please.
Good morning, Convener and Committee. Thank you very much for allowing the Law Society to participate in this. The major issue facing practitioners, civil legal aid practitioners, is that they support the most vulnerable in society, including people suffering from mental illness or victims of domestic abuse. Increasingly, fewer lawyers are offering to do legal aid. Those who continue are swamped. Thus, it is common for them to stop taking on new cases because of the heavy workload. Women's aid organisations have told me that they are unable to find civil legal aid lawyers and have sought funding from charitable organisations to pay for lawyers outside the legal aid system. Additionally, the number of legal aid lawyers in the Highlands and Borders who are willing to take part in the Children's Duty Plan is extremely low. For example, in Inverness and Elgin, there are 15 firms listed on the duty plan, but only one of them is local. There is also a problem with adults with incapacity cases. This is a rising demand for this, and yet there aren't the legal aid lawyers available to meet that need. Last year, the Scottish Government scheme to part fund 40 trainees in the legal aid sector has been welcomed by the Law Society and the profession. However, newly qualified solicitors are being offered a third more than legal aid firms can offer by people in private practice or other areas. Without urgent action, there will be further decline. The question is, how do we retain lawyers in this sector? The setting up of an annual review of fees is essential for legal aid firms to be able to demonstrate to graduates that this area of law has a future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And if we can now go to Jen Ange, please.
Yep. Thank you very much for this opportunity to give evidence today at committee on access to justice and specifically on how the current political, economic and regulatory environment has impacted access to services and service delivery by third sector organisations and legal charities like ours. Just Right Scotland as a charity was founded by human rights lawyers to defend and extend people's rights in Scotland. We do that by providing free confidential legal advice to people across Scotland in areas where there are gaps in access to specialist advice, and that includes women's rights and survivors of gender-based violence through the Scottish Women's Rights Centre. I think there'll be some echoing of what Jim Stevenson has just said here. Also, survivors of trafficking and labour exploitation through our Anti-Trafficking and Exploitation Centre. Unaccompanied asylum-seeking children and migrant women fleeing violence through our Refugee and Migrant Centre. And people facing disability discrimination, race discrimination, and discrimination on account of their sex or LGBT plus identity through the Scottish Just Law Centre. We also run the Ukraine Advice Scotland project, which provides free advice to Ukrainians and their families on seeking safe routes to Scotland. And what I'd like to emphasise is that we run those services on a combination of private charitable trust funding, some core Scottish Government funding, and a tiny bit of legal aid funding. What I'm pointing out is actually there are a range of solutions that feed into meeting this access to justice gap, and we need to have a full and frank conversation about what we and other organisations need to continue to do this work. In brief, as you would expect, we continue to see demand for our services outstrip our capacity to meet that demand. And that's the reason why we work in partnership with other lawyers and advice organisations, including Citizens Advice Scotland here today, Shelter Scotland, Govan Law Centre. We all understand that the most efficient means of addressing this gap is to work together when there's such scarcity of resource. And we're also here to highlight that the burden of continuing to address this gap must not fall only on the third sector, on private charitable funding, and on our colleagues to work harder and smarter and faster, but mostly harder. As you'll be aware, we think that this has in part to do with the slow disintegration of the civil legal advice sector in areas of social justice law in particular. And those are areas like public law and housing and welfare and community care and immigration and asylum, all areas where potentially the market doesn't provide sufficient incentive for people already in practice to step in. And we'd also highlight that in specialist legal areas like domestic violence, sexual harassment, trafficking and labour exploitation, there's more that needs to be done in Scotland, which is to say that there might be lawyers willing to take up that work, but the infrastructure, the support, the funding to do that needs to be thought through. I'm aware that this is a wee bit long, so I'm just going to scooch forwards. And see, something we'd really like to discuss today is actually how we can work together and how Scottish Government can work on a more unified footing to look at its obligations under international law to provide for access to justice across the board, and specifically to look at its own vision for justice strategy and to meet those ambitions. We think that what's needed is a clear understanding of all the areas where duty arises on Scottish Government to ensure access for justice, both in the civil and the criminal legal systems. An understanding of where there are gaps and barriers in access to advice now and what's causing those gaps, because there are short and long-term solutions. An understanding of those longer-term opportunities like the Human Rights Bill, but also threats like the continuing erosion of the number of lawyers and advisers who are being recruited, trained and progressed in these roles. And finally, a focused and comprehensive strategy with resource over more than 5 years to reverse those trends. So we'd like to answer your question about widening gaps. We do think that this is increasingly urgent in light of our experience and what my colleagues, I'm sure, will share around the impact of the pandemic, our response, as well as the cost of living crisis. I won't rehearse the evidence here, but I think we all accept that those things have increased inequality in Scotland. And so just in conclusion, we would submit that a country like Scotland, with the resource and the ambition to be a world leader, can do better. And we welcome this opportunity to start conversation about the levers or the mechanisms that we could employ to take that longer term approach to addressing this problem. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Fiona McPhail, please.
Good morning, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. I would echo what both Jim Stevenson and Jen Ang have said today. I would also refer to the written evidence that Shelter Scotland has submitted to the Committee. The starting point here, I think, has already been said, is that this is an exacerbation of a pre-existing structural inequalities. Our human rights law, domestic law, has long recognised that eviction is the most severe form of interference with the right to respect for the home enshrined in Article 8 of the European Convention of Human Rights. Scotland can proudly boast some of the strongest legal protections for tenants across both the public and private sector, as well as for homeless people. Yet the scandalous truth is, for years, many tenants and homeless people have been denied access to justice. And we can look at the fundamental reasons for that in terms of the structural inequalities, the lack of social housing and the inadequately funded statutory services. But in the context of the delivery of our services, I believe that the barriers to access to justice fall under three broad themes. There is a lack of awareness of rights. And we see this commonly in the field of homelessness with clients who have presented as homeless to a local authority and taken at face value what they have been told. Sorry, we have no accommodation available today. Come back tomorrow. Or you do not have a local connection. Go back to X place. And people will spend weeks in that situation before they are too desperate and have no other option but to get advice. The second reason is to do with the complexity of needs and the vulnerability of these clients. Not only might they be facing eviction or already homeless, but many of our clients present highly distressed, mentally and physically disabled. We're noticing an increase in the number of disabled clients that are approaching our services. Many will be fleeing domestic violence, and many, if not all, will be in financial insecurity. Any one of those factors presents a challenge, but to be navigating or dealing with all of those does seem to be quite unfathomable. And the third and main barrier, arguably, and the one that I would be grateful to discuss further today, concerns the lack of specialist advice services. As colleagues have already said today, here we can have the strongest legal rights in place, we can know about those rights, but if we can't get through the door and access the specialist advisor or the lawyer, those rights are questionable in terms of their practical and in terms of their meaningfulness. When it comes to the delivery of those services, as has already been said, people in housing crisis are almost entirely reliant on the third sector, a third sector that is dealing with increasing demand, a third sector that has to look at an increasingly competitive funding pool and that does struggle to recruit, train and retain staff. So we are in that housing emergency, and Shelters Scotland's call here is for an emergency response. Aside from building more social housing and adequately funding our services, let's look at the issue of access to justice. And I think tinkering around the edges is something that we have done and need to continue doing, but we need at this stage now where we need radical and root and branch reform. The pandemic has taught many important lessons to us. I think the legal profession has reacted very well. We are now delivering a combination of remote and in-person services. Many of us will offer digital advice, but we do have more fundamental issues here when the queues of people are growing and we're not able to offer access to justice, which is such a fundamental right.
Thank you. We'll now go to Gillian Fife, please.
Thank you for the opportunity to provide evidence this morning. The Citizens Advice Network, comprised of Citizens Advice Scotland, CAS, the Extra Help Unit and our 59 member bureau, together form Scotland's largest independent advice network. Advice provided by our service is free, independent, confidential, impartial and available to everyone. We look at the problems people bring to our advice services and campaign and advocate for change where it's needed most. We work for a fairer Scotland where people are empowered and their rights respected. During January 2023, Scottish CABS helped more than 22,000 people by providing over 93,000 pieces of advice. This represents a 10% increase on client numbers compared to January 2022. In addition, our online advice pages saw the highest number of page views outside of the pandemic and the third highest number of page views ever. These figures demonstrate the cost of living crisis is driving an increased demand for advice across the Citizens Advice Network. Advice related to access to justice forms an important part of the work of the Citizens Advice Network, with more than 3,000 pieces of advice on legal proceedings being provided in an average month. During 2022, the most common access to justice issues on which advice was provided were simple procedure, benefits tribunals, incapacity, legal aid and solicitors and advocates. While advice provided on legal proceedings by CAB can be wide-ranging, we are aware of some common issues faced by clients, such as accessing a practitioner who will take on a case funded by legal aid, issues with supply of legal practitioners in certain parts of the country in relation to particular areas of specialism, and issues with the accessibility of virtual or remote proceedings. And I would hope to expand on some of these points during the session. The economic value of advice provided by Citizens Advice Bureau on legal proceedings is an estimated £11.58 million, and this clearly demonstrates the effective early intervention and prevention role which the Citizens Advice Network plays in Scotland. Therefore, it's crucial, we believe, that Citizens Advice Bureau and any specialist access to justice projects which they run, such as in-court advice, is funded on a consistent and long-term basis in order to help improve outcomes for people. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Rachel Moon, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for inviting Govan Law Centre to be here today. We're grateful to be here. Govan Law Centre are a multidisciplinary service in that we provide housing debt, welfare rights and legal advice from advisor level to solicitor advocacy level. And it's all in-house, so it means we can work fast and we can work efficiently. It means we can identify strategic challenges and act on them quickly. But we're just after rounds of funding that we have lost out on, we've lost staff and we're just too lean to be able to take the strategic litigation that we would wish to take on a daily basis or a weekly basis. As a result of the impact of COVID-19 with the cost of living crisis, Brexit and inflation running at 10%, our cases are more complex, they are more time consuming, and being under-resourced means that we can't act in the way we want to be acting. What we would call upon is the better funding and investment into specialist advice network, but also strategic work to allow us to progress and move the boundaries of equalities law. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Colin Lancaster, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be part of this morning's roundtable. The panel, as you've heard, encompasses public, private and third sectors, specialists, generalists, national, local, legal and other advisers. It's a good demonstration of the range of services and the ways of organising services that operate in this sphere. The knowledge, skills and commitment of this wide range of providers is a huge strength, from which people in need of advice and representation benefit enormously. But this multifaceted approach also poses a challenge. It can be complex to navigate for those seeking help, and the lack of strategic planning and coordination can result in inconsistency of access between geographic areas, areas of law, and over time. Legal aid is just one part of this rich but complex and at times inconsistent pattern of provision. The system is demand-led, which can make it responsive to changes in need. But there is no mechanism for connecting need, demand and supply, or of targeting resources at priority issues, or securing a consistent level of service in any given place or for a particular type of problem. The legal aid schemes are themselves complex and can be confusing for the public and for providers, and indeed for SLAB at times. Legal aid should be a means to resolve problems, not a specialist subject in itself. The legislation is approaching 40 years old, and even that was based largely on schemes from the 50s, 60s and 70s. This system continues to support many of those who might otherwise not be able to access the services they need to help them exercise their rights, defend themselves against criminal charges, challenge those who abuse power or use the law to secure a better future for themselves and their families. But it would be truly remarkable if a system designed over 70 years ago was able to respond effectively to the range of problems that we see today, or encompass what we've learned about patterns of need, about user-focused, trauma-informed, joined-up models of service delivery. To do that, the system needs redesigning with current and future needs in mind, to provide clear access to advice for the public, a reduced administrative burden for providers, and by incorporating a range of funding and delivery models, the possibility of a structure that can attract and retain talented and committed lawyers and advisors. That kind of change needs new primary legislation, and we're hopeful that will be forthcoming soon. We look forward to working with partners such as those here today, and indeed the committee, to shape a responsive, comprehensive and accessible legal aid system for the future. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks very much. So thanks everyone for those introductory remarks. We're now going to move on to questions and discussion, and I'll ask Pam Duncan-Glancy to kick the discussion off.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone who's joined us. Thank you for the information you've given us in advance. It's been really helpful, and also for the supplementary information you've given just now. I had prepared some questions to ask in advance, but I've got a few that have just arisen out of some of the comments, which I guess is the nature of the discussion. The first I'd like to focus on is around the areas of information that people are seeking. And if it's okay, Fiona, if I could come to yourselves in terms of housing. and I'll come to debt shortly after. In the submission that you gave us, you noted that women experiencing domestic violence, and I note that Jim also mentioned this, have specific issues. What are the specific issues that you refer to in terms of access to justice, and what can be done?
So I think in the context of housing and predominantly homelessness, it's women fleeing domestic violence, and we have seen an increase in that during the pandemic. What we see at Shelter Scotland, and regrettably what we are dealing with in the context of homelessness, is breach of statutory duty, where a local authority are not providing temporary accommodation where they otherwise have a statutory obligation to.
Specifically for women fleeing domestic violence?
That applies to not just women, yep. But that's a general problem that we see. So the three main categories of homeless cases we deal with are local authorities who have failed to take an application, or who have taken an application but failed to secure accommodation, normally because they don't have accommodation available. Or lastly, it's people who are being offered temporary accommodation but they're challenging the suitability of that accommodation.
And what options are open to people when they do try to challenge that?
So the legal remedy there is judicial review. Yeah. That has kept us very busy recently. And there are circumstances where we can't take those cases on because we don't have the capacity. So that this is a prime example of where somebody will contact Shelter, be given the specialist advice by one of our advisors, and those advisors will contact local authorities. There'll be advocacy undertaken by Shelter, but unless there is a lawyer that's able to take a case or threaten judicial review, those cases tend to get stuck, or can get stuck. Our advisors do have a high success rate in challenging, but I think it demonstrates that there needs to be more than just knowledge of rights.
I think also in your submission you talk about the need for the strategic litigation and so that organisations could have standing in cases in the future. Could you tell us a bit more about that, particularly in relation to the incorporation bill?
Okay. So I think here what we've seen again in the context of homelessness, we will, by the time these cases come to us in the law service, we will be threatening judicial review. Most of those cases will resolve at the point of a threat and therefore will not go to a substantive hearing. And I think one of the, whilst extremely beneficial for the individual concerned, they get the outcome that they need. What we've got here are underlying issues, whether it's a practice that a local authority has or just a failure to look at the systems issues. The underlying issues are not being addressed, and so we're hoping through the Human Rights Bill that the test for standing is expanded so that there is, that, for example, Shelter or groups of people are able to take action to challenge these issues, if that makes sense.
It does. Thank you. I appreciate that. Also, the point that you made in your submission around the unsuitable temporary homelessness accommodation and the recent, I'm just going to get this correct, the Inner House of Court Session judgment. Can you tell us a bit about what that means for the people that you're working with and what we'd need to do to remedy that?
Yes, OK, so that is a case that was taken by Govan Law Centre. Shelter Scotland intervened in that matter, and that was a case that challenged or sought to... it was a case concerning statutory interpretation of an amendment to the Unsuitable Accommodation Scotland Order, an amendment made in 2021 that requires local authorities to take into account the needs of a homeless household. And the Court of Session, in considering that, held that taking into account is not the same as meeting the needs. At first instance, the court, the Lord Ordinary, had held that taking into account effectively meant meet the needs. Mm. And that was significant because where we have, in the case of X, it was a child with autism, and it was decided that that child needed their own room. It might be a woman fleeing domestic violence who should not be placed in a hostel with men, for example. It could be people... who are recovering from addiction, again, who will say they don't want to go into hostel-type accommodation. These are needs that are not otherwise protected or covered by the remainder of the unsuitable accommodation order. So Shelter Scotland, to remedy, I suppose, the decision in X, the Outer House, would be to amend the legislation and substitute taking into account needs with meet the special needs.
Thank you. And I'm going to pick up, I think, some of the kind of strategic litigation in a second when I'm, as I move on to my next kind of line of questions around debt, if that's OK. Gillian, if I could maybe bring you in on this. The debt appears as one of the main reasons that people seek either advice or the main reason that that people use civil remedy. Can you tell us a bit about what kind of support you think people need just now and where the gaps are? And then I'm also interested, a few things here. I'm also interested in the model that you described through Citizens Advice Scotland and the model that, Rachel, you described through the Govan Law Centre. It would appear that we kind of basically need both of those things to be available across the piece. So there's advice available as well as legal advice available, and that could begin to address some of the strategic litigation issues. So that's a slightly broader question, just because we were talking about strategic litigation in the general question there, I thought I'd mention it whilst I'm asking Gillian about debt as well as the other question.
Gillian.
Thank you. I suppose historically, debt is one of our biggest advice areas in terms of the largest advice area that people seek advice from the Citizens Advice Network, and it tends to be benefits and then it tends to be debt. What we saw in terms of December, our data, we actually saw energy advice overtake advice on universal credit. And I think that gives an indication of what we're seeing in terms of debt in relation to utilities, as well as now kind of coming up the agenda, and we're also seeing increases in advice on food banks and also around face eviction and sort of home repossession. So it's across a number of issues that people will come to the network for advice related to debt. In terms of the kind of service delivery model, I'd agree with Pam Duncan Glancy that there's a need for both holistic advice to individuals and increased vision of legal advice through increased supply and access to practitioners. I think both are needed. I think in terms of the advice sector, it's a very good method of early intervention and prevention and triaging to understand if an individual does need to seek legal advice or whether they can solve their issue without the advice of a current legal practitioner.
Thanks. And I think Pam was looking for... Were you looking for Rachel to say a few words on that as well? Was that?
Yeah, connected to the point that Jill mentioned.
So the Law Centre model that goes from advice up to solicitor advocacy level, when I'm talking about strategic litigation, that's kind of what I mean, that we can go from, you know, an advisor who's speaking to 10 clients a day or across an organisation. Those cases can be filtered through quite quickly. And in terms of suitability of accommodation, we can start to judicially review them really quickly rather than trying to look for outside legal advice that could take it, apply for legal aid. Quite often you've already got legal aid from your advisor level. You've got all the details already. You've spoken to the client. You're looking to just move it and progress it quickly. If there are reports that say that accommodation is unsuitable, we should be moving fast. It shouldn't be accepted that there are kids living in unsuitable accommodation. And I think to put a bit of colour to it or context to it, the cases that we're seeing kind of reflect what you were saying, Fiona, about children with autism. And these families, the one I've got in my email right now, is a family that is in a high-rise flat with a sort of window that's a bit like a balcony. And she's got countless reports from medical professionals that say that child has tried to jump out of the window, and there's a huge risk and a huge concern there. Now, that's a case that should be moved on really fast. And if there isn't the resources there, then you can't take that to judicial review very quickly. And you've got all these waiting lists of unsuitable accommodation. So that's part of the housing crisis. But if you've got more investment in that sort of strategic work, then, you know, if there's a funnel of all these cases going through, then it can only help to show that more investment is needed in that housing sector.
The resource, do you mean in terms of legal aid, or do you mean in terms of the availability of lawyers and solicitors, or both?
Maybe a bit of both, but actually we've found that in terms of those cases, legal aid is usually granted, actually. So it's just a case of filtering those cases through to the relevant legal professional. But then to do a judicial review, you need someone with rights of audience, so you need an advocate to be able to draft that application to get it into the court session. So unless we feel very powerful in our organisation to have that, but there's many, most don't. And if you don't have a referral route to be able to get that advice and advocacy in place, then these cases just aren't getting taken. And we do have some success with the threat of judicial review, but I've found that you need to be able to act on it.
Incredibly.
Because you're speaking to the same lawyers in the legal team. So unless you're then following it through by acting fairly quickly, by showing you've got special urgency legal aid in place to take that forward, then that's the time where I think that the client is provided with relevant accommodation.
You said that you feel quite lucky because you've got access to that provision.
In Govan Law Centre, we've got Mike Daly's the principal solicitor, and he's a solicitor advocate, so he has the rights of audience necessary to draft the paperwork and appear in the court of session. So we can go from advisor level, which is someone speaking on the phone, sifting through these cases. I'm across from her, so I'll speak to her about how unsuitable accommodation is. So it can move to me fairly fast, and then it can go to Mike Daly fairly fast to get that to court. And it feels like that is how we get through these cases and get people in suitable accommodation. But that the case that Fiona and yourself were talking about, that was such a boon for housing lawyers to see that what we have been arguing for so long, that there's an absolute duty there to house someone in suitable accommodation. That has given all of us, you know, that power behind us to keep taking these cases. And it's not about resources, it's about providing that house that's suitable for a family or an applicant's needs.
Thank you. Convener, will I move to the next area question or to someone else?
I'm going to let somebody else come in and you can come back into that other area. Yep. Fulton, shall we go to you next? Thanks. Fulton McGregor.
Convener, would you maybe want to let Karen in, so I don't want to step on any toes and then I'll come in after Karen?
It was more in terms of the access to services.
All right, okay.
Area. Yeah.
Sorry, folks.
Sorry.
So I was going to come in on the domestic abuse. Aye. So apologies for that. And that's one of the risks with an informal round table. Totally messed up there. Anyway, thanks very much and good morning, everybody. Yeah, in terms of services, obviously, I think Pam Duncan-Glancy touched on it a wee bit. There's probably a question for yourself, Rachel, initially, and then maybe yourself, Jim. I'm a amateur MSP, and I noticed that there is difference of services across the country. So, for example, I think yourself, Rachel, you only deal with people with a Glasgow postcode. Is that correct? And therefore, if you take maybe like Lanarkshire, which is close to Glasgow, they don't have a similar sort of service, and your own service is very well known about and thought of, I have to say, as well. So I just wonder, what do you think about that provision of services across the country? What more can we do? What can this committee do in conjunction with the Scottish Government or other partners to ensure there's a consistency of service across the whole country.
Glasgow, mainly the northeast and the south of Glasgow, and absolutely we get contacted, as I'm sure other organisations do, almost on a daily basis by people looking for advice, particularly actually by online, like Twitter or something, that people get in touch with us asking if we can take on a client. We don't take on those cases routinely, but we do act on a pro bono basis if we think there's some strategic element to the case that could have a wider benefit. But certainly, in terms of who we would refer to there, you know, we're saying go to the Law Society, see if there's a local lawyer that would be able to take that on, citizens advice bureaus. But other than that, law centres are predominantly in Glasgow. So there's even we feel that we're under resourced, we feel that we can't take on the necessary cases that we want to, never mind elsewhere. So in terms of what you can do about it, which was your question, I don't want to keep banging on about it, but more investment. You know, the law centres in Glasgow are kind of full to capacity in terms of the casework they take on, and it's not really good enough to just take on to rely on taking on strategic cases outside the Glasgow areas on a pro bono basis. It's not sustainable. So I guess you'd need significant investment to widen that outside Glasgow.
Yeah, thanks, Rachel. Jim, I wonder if I can ask you the same sort of question, but widen it out to, in your views, do you think there's any particular challenges for people exercising their human rights in combating discrimination?
Yeah, I think the problem arises and I alluded to it, is the newly qualified solicitors who are leaving this area. So there's a plenty of people who leave university and want to go into legal aid traineeships, but then when they qualify, they look for a better work-life balance. And the workload that legal aid lawyers are facing, and certainly second-year trainees are facing, it's a heavy workload, and it's too heavy for them to sustain. And that's why firms have to turn away business, because they can't deal with it, even though they may be coming from Scottish Women's Aid or somewhere like that, and we feel very hard pushed about it. But we have to address this problem, and I don't know how we address the problem. It's a gender-based thing as well. A lot of women leave the profession in the early years, and we need to address that problem. Now, I think it's across the board we have to address the problem. I know Colin's got views on this as well, but it's the whole justice system has to look at it and say, how can we retain these people? Because if we retain the people, they're available to give advice. But these are also the people that will end up being sheriffs and judges and administering the law. So it's important that we open up this and discuss this, not just on a money basis, but work-life balance basis. So a civil legal aid lawyer, if you get their business card, will have their mobile phone number on it. They're available 24/7 almost, but they alone can't deal with what's coming through the door. And this is the problem. There is, and during the pandemic, virtual courts were used, which certainly helped in relation to rural areas, that they could get access to the legal profession. There are problems with the virtual courts, and the major problem is you've got to have effective participation with the parties who are involved in the action. That may be that the solicitor and the client are in the same room, because the solicitor has to encourage the client to speak up and state their views. There's no point in having an online court or virtual court if the person is not participating effectively. So these are the areas that we could look at and could progress, which would greatly help the situation. And they could be built into a further review of, you know, the fee review body could also look at these issues as well. And this is why the Law Society are very keen to get a body, maybe an independent body, to look at these things and so to ensure that we have enough solicitors to meet the need that is overwhelming at the moment.
So are you happy to leave it there?
Jen is keen to come in, and I think Karen's looking for a sup in this area. So.
Okay. Thank you very much, Convener. I just wanted to quickly take the opportunity to answer both questions that have been raised, both Pam and Fulton's, in relation to what are some of the issues we could look at in ensuring a consistency of high-quality provision across Scotland in a specialist area. By speaking a little bit about the Scottish Women's Rights Centre, which is funded to provide advocacy, legal information, advice and representation across Scotland for women fleeing gender-based violence. The Scottish Women's Rights Centre is a collaboration between Just Right Scotland, Scottish Rape Crisis, and the Strathclyde Law Clinic, and it has been running for a number of years, and it's grant funded, so it's core funded in a way that makes it a good model to examine. It's unusual as a response. So we have advocacy workers working alongside our solicitors and legal caseworkers, and we've worked to use that advocacy base in order to provide more information about legal rights and information to people kind of at the front, or what we call sort of early intervention to legal advice. And we have a Scotland-wide remit, which has been really challenging. I think it's one of the reasons the project was seen as promising to be funded, but I think we're in a really good position to tell you about some of the gaps and some of the challenges that arise here that will arise in other areas of law that are specialist. So what we've seen is we can provide through rape crisis networks, but also women's aid networks, as much great kind of frontline information about people's rights as possible. But there is a restriction. There's a bottleneck even for us when it comes to referrals for individual legal advice and representation. right? And it's actually there is a bit of responsibility that we bear here when we're advising people who are seeking to escape abusive and exploitative situations, when we advise them that they have rights and that our statutory authorities will conduct themselves in a certain way. If we do not provide them not the support, but actually the legal advice and representation that they need to engage with those systems, we are letting them down. So as an example, a woman who's fleeing a situation of domestic violence in the Central Belt as compared to someone who is fleeing the same sort of factual circumstances in a more remote area may be able to access in-person support through advocacy locally, may be able to access our services remotely, which has become a more frequent and more accepted approach. But there will come a point where it's not possible to deliver a person-centred, trauma-informed model to meet with that person again and again and again, perhaps even in the steps preceding her decision to exercise her legal rights. It may not, probably will not be possible to find a lawyer that is a safe distance, that isn't linked into her communities, to see her. And that is simple inequality. And that difference will have real impacts in women's lives across Scotland. Some of the things that we have looked at or that the centre is doing to address this problem probably illustrates the strategy and our approach. As I said, that there are lawyers across Scotland who would like to work in a more trauma-informed approach, who would like to be able to take some of these cases, who have the skills to do that. And the Scottish Women's Rights Centre does now run a kind of training and accreditation programme, which is relatively light touch, I suppose, but it's aiming to create a network of lawyers or to upskill lawyers across geographies who feel confident to do this work, but it's only a partial answer, I suppose. But the second longer term piece, and it's something that we cannot address alone, and it's what, you know, Jim has spoken to, it's what Rachel and Fiona have spoken to, is we cannot, unless you fund specific people to do this work, we cannot magic up the capacity in already stretched firms. So as much as people are willing, they are right and they're acting within their ethical obligations to not take on more casework than they can handle, particularly when these are complex, sort of high contact hours cases, as they should be, because people in these situations deserve that intensity of advice. So I know that was a bit of a kind of meander, but I hope it starts to explore some of the impacts of those questions. I think that if we were to look at how we measure our success, it would be ultimately being able to run a survey Scotland-wide, asking people if they've had particular legal issues to engage with, and then asking about the quality and the speed and the rights-affirmingness of the response that they were able to obtain no matter where they lived.
Thank you. And Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener. It was just something you spoke about there, Jim, in regards to women's participation in legal services and them dropping out. We recently had a gender-sensitive audit of the Parliament. Myself and my colleague Maggie Chapman were both members on this board, and we were looking into the participation and the barriers that faced women's participation in politics as a whole and in the Parliament, because we know the better representation of women here, the better women are served across Scotland. And I'm just wondering if that would be something that would be considered, to do a gender-sensitive audit, because we know that a lot of the issues that we're hearing this morning do disproportionately affect women.
Yes, so the Law Society do a survey of its members. The last survey was done in 2018, and they're currently preparing for a further survey. And I'll feed back into that these issues that should be done, but it's quite a broad survey. The difficulty sometimes be is the structure of the court system that is a barrier. So if you're, and I know we're talking about civil, so talking about civil proofs may run for a period of time. It doesn't help with hybrid working if you want to only work certain days of the week, or you prefer to work 7 days of the week. It's very difficult if you've got a 6-day proof that's set down before a court. So it's not just the employer, as in the law firm, that faces the problems. It's the court system itself, and how we can do that, because sometimes it's seen that you have to do these proofs and such like that to progress through a firm. I don't particularly subscribe to that view. I think people should be progressing according to their ability, and there shouldn't be any barriers to that. But certainly the Law Society look at barriers and try to address barriers, and their latest survey will do that.
Okay, thank you.
And Colin would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. The points Jim made are, I think, well made there, and it's an issue that we've been aware of for some time and in discussions with the Law Society and the Government and the Faculty of Advocates. So that group is currently considering some work around the future of the profession and trying to identify what barriers or challenges there might be and how they might be overcome, and whether that is to do with the sorts of structural barriers that Jim has mentioned in relation to the wider operation of the criminal justice system, or whether there are things about the way in which services are structured and delivered and funded that could actually help address some of those issues. We've got a legal aid sector which is predominantly very small firms. Many of them are one- or two-person firms. In fact, I think it's more than half of the firms are one or two people. And I think there are challenges there in terms of managing workloads when there are maybe unpredictable features, particularly in relation to crime, where there might be police station work requiring out-of-hours call-outs, but also, as Jim mentioned there, longer-running trials in crime or proofs in civil. And I think there's maybe a challenge in terms of the flexibility of some of those models of delivery. And so it might be that there's a need to look at whether there are ways of supporting the profession generally to address those kind of barriers and create opportunities, because I think at the moment it's two-thirds or so of new entrants into the profession are women. The profession has been over 50% women for a decade or so, but we do see that there's a certain point, particularly again in criminal practice, where women certainly come in to that area of work, but they tend to then move on or move into publicly employed positions, so move in-house, move into the Crown or other areas where I think they find that flexible working arrangements are more readily available. And I think that can be a challenge in some of the smaller business units that they're traditionally based in.
So I think Fiona would like to come in, and then we'll go to Rachel Hamilton. Fiona.
Thank you. I wanted to come back on Fulton's question to Rachel about, Lanarkshire. So the Shelter Housing Law Service is a national service, and we will take cases throughout Scotland where we have capacity. But to come back to your question about what could be done, there's obviously an underlying issue and a difficult issue here in terms of resources, and we're all asking for more funding and more sustainable funding avenues. But there's also a question here of principle, and if we put access to justice on a par with access to healthcare, or if we look at in the context of criminal where we have duty schemes. Some of us in the Law Centre movement offering court advice to those at risk of eviction, but there's not a consistency. Not every single housing court has access to that, and not every tenant will have automatic access to a housing lawyer. And what's saddening about that is we know from the cases we take, the vast majority of those, there'll be a legal defence, the vast majority of people we're taking on will successfully keep their homes with that advice. And it's the difference that makes. We know about the social and economic cost of carrying through with an eviction. So if we are looking at a new redesigning a legal aid system and looking at access to justice here, it's perhaps looking at identifying those areas where we need to just think differently about it, and why don't people, for sake of argument, at risk of eviction have automatic access to legal advice in the same way that those that are at risk of losing their liberty do? So just a proposal, something to think about. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton, please.
Well, on this particular theme of access, we know that 100 lawyers have quit the legal aid system. We know that 40 legal aid firms have quit the system. We know that the Scottish Government have reduced their budget since 2007 by £65 million. So we've talked about resource, we've talked about recruitment and retaining staff, but I'm wondering, whether there's lots of solutions around this, but do the Scottish Government, or could they do anything more within their legislative competence or regulatory powers that they do have, to ensure that we do address these issues? Can I go to Jim first? Because I know on this point, the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association have been very critical about the latest legal aid, which they say that doesn't go far enough to address those recruitment and retainment issues.
Yes, yeah, so I've talked about the trainees thing, which was very welcome, and there was about £1 million that was spent on the trainees to fund 40 trainees in legal aid sectors. Some of those have obviously gone to criminal and a few have gone to civil. The Scottish Government also announced an £11 million package, which I understand that the regulations have been laid before the Parliament, and Colin can support me on this, and I think will come into effect on the end of this month, the end of April. The situation here is that there have been ongoing negotiations with the Scottish Government, the Legal Aid Board, about the provision of legal aid. I also sat on legal aid a long time ago, and it's been a constant theme that it's been underfunded and that this is one of the major problems with it. When the £11 million came out, it wasn't welcomed by the Law Society as a solution. It was a step in the right direction. But what really needs to be done is, and I harp back to my opening comments, we need to have an independent review so that the people coming into the profession can see, like you see with teachers and other professions, that there will be some sort of increase each year, or it will be looked at, the problems they have about work and life balance is addressed, the problems they have about barriers is addressed. So this is what we could move forward with, and that body doesn't just address fees, but addresses the other issues in the matter. And this is what the Law Society are very keen on, and the Scottish Bar Association are very keen on bringing in. We had a legal aid review, which I think was 5 years ago now. Nothing's moved forward. I fully understand the pandemic's taken place, but the thing is, we've reached this crisis now because nothing has moved forward. We need this review. We need this independent body to look at these things, which can address the funding issues right across the board, not just legal aid, but other funding, because I know that third sector, who lawyers rely heavily on, they get funding for maybe short periods of time and not long enough periods of time to fund a whole project. The women's aid groups are always finding difficulty finding funding to get access to legal provision. So I think we could look at this in a bigger picture and look at it with maybe some sort of independent body set up by the Scottish Government. That's what I would say about it.
Gillian would like to come in as well, if that's okay, Rachel.
Yes.
Gillian.
In terms of addressing some of the issues with access, it might be a case that the way the legal aid budget is set up needs to be looked at in terms of shifting focus to more grant funding, contracting, to deal with some of those areas where there are supply issues. And also the focus, if it was shifted to more grant funding, it's focused on early intervention and prevention. And as kind of Jim touched on there, some of the projects that are currently funded that run in citizens' advice bureau at the moment, particularly in court advice, we believe that these need to be funded on a national basis because, as others have said, not everyone in every part of the country can get access to the same service at the moment. And also we think that funding needs to be made more consistent because it's year-on-year funding at the moment, and that's really an issue for supporting clients, ensuring good outcomes, and also job security for the staff involved. So that is really a barrier, the kind of funding issue again in terms of access. But as I said, I think maybe the budget overall in terms of using that in a different way to fill some of the gaps and address some of the access issues might be a good way to look at this issue.
Thanks. And Colin?
Thank you, Convener. Just to pick up Rachel Hamilton's question there, I suppose there are two or three different things there. I mean, first of all, in terms of the budget for legal aid, it is demand-led, and therefore it will fluctuate over time depending on the number of cases that come through the system, and it will rise if the number of cases coming through rises. So we're rising at the moment, and some of that's a bounce back from dips in the pandemic, but by the end of this financial year, we'll be spending more than we were pre-pandemic. The long-term reduction in legal aid expenditure up until the pandemic was largely driven by reductions in the number of criminal cases cases going through the courts, and therefore demand for advice was lower, and therefore for spend was lower. What we've seen on the civil legal aid side is that the number of grants of civil legal aid over the last 2 or 3 years, even with a slight dip in the pandemic, has actually been pretty similar to the numbers that we saw 5, 10 years ago. So there's not a huge reduction there, but there are fewer people delivering those cases, acting in those cases. Again, as I mentioned earlier, a large number of the firms that do legal aid work are very small, and many of those firms who have been active, and we define active as submitting one or more applications in a year, have been at that one or two application end of the spectrum. So there's always been a disproportionate concentration of the work amongst a smaller number of firms who tend to specialise. So law centres in relation to social welfare law dominate that provision. And generally speaking, and when I say historically, I mean over 30, 40 years, mainstream private sector, private practice, legal aid provision has not tended to do an awful lot of social welfare law work. So in terms of housing, for example, it has very much been the third sector who has picked that up. That's why law centres emerged in the first place, because mainstream legal aid services were not addressing those needs. And therefore, there's a different model identified for doing that. And that's the model that Rachel described earlier. So in terms of what might be done to address any gaps that do emerge, and I would say that, again, over the last 10, 15 years, what we've seen is a change in the types of work that are being done under legal aid. 15, 20 years ago, it would be family law and damages actions. Damages actions barely feature now because no win, no fee is entirely taken care of that. So it's now family, adults with incapacity, Jim mentioned, it's the biggest single area of work. More grants this year than ever. It goes up every year, and that is very widespread across the country. Lots of mental health work under advice and assistance and ABOR for the Mental Health Tribunal, immigration and asylum work. These were not major features of the legal aid system historically, but have grown over time. So there may still be some gaps in the system, some areas of the country, not necessarily rural, but there may be some parts of the country where it's harder to get help than in others. But as I mentioned in my introductory remarks, the system is reactive, it's demand-led. There are very few tools for us, for the government or any other body, to intervene directly, to identify needs, to look at the patterns of supply, and to then make changes happen where those things don't match up. We've got fairly limited grant funding powers, and that helps on the margins, and a number of bodies here have received grants from us over the years or still do. But in terms of the balance, if what the public needs is a more interventionist system, then a different set of tools are really needed. And I think this is what Jen was saying earlier on, really thinking about what is the system we want in future that provides an assurance, a consistency of service delivery, rather than just paying for the work that gets done if it gets done. So that idea of being proactive, making it our business to understand the patterns of need and then design services to meet those needs. That's not really what the current legal aid system is designed to do. And it can't be made to do it because the tools just aren't there. But I would agree with others that more diverse range of models, both funding models and delivery models, is what we need to meet the diverse range of needs that we observe.
Jen, can I just ask you, when you did talk about the levers and mechanisms, was it specifically about the funding models and the early intervention?
Thank you for that question, Rachel. I suppose I helpfully at the start suggested that if this committee has the powers, it might be interesting to open up a wider look or to press Scottish Government to speak more to how it seeks to meet its access to justice obligations across directorates and across areas of responsibility in a kind of unified way. I think that as organisations that receive funding from them or are working across those, the national law centres and also organisations like Citizens Advice Scotland are in a really good position to feedback. But I do think that you will see that across directorates or areas of responsibility, so children's rights versus women's rights versus local government and communities, you see people recognising access to justice as a component of their responsibility, but not actually that wider tying together conversation about how we could tackle this better. The other thing, just to kind of round out your question around what other levers and mechanisms or what could Scottish Government do within its powers, I guess I wanted to point out that governments, so the Scottish Government and the UK Government, play an active role in demand for legal services in how they legislate. So we have gaps because demand exceeds supply. And lawyers will tell you in their specialist areas when they see something coming down the pike that this will massively increase demand for legal service. So for example, the illegal migration bill is going to massively increase demand for immigration advice services, and everyone knows that, and we won't be able to meet it. Similarly, repeated poor decision-making by DWP massively increases demand for the work that Citizens Advice does, along with CPAG. A lot of that work is done at advisor level because there are not enough lawyers to take the kind of the higher level appeals. But it is government legislation or bureaucratic decision making that creates that. What's within the powers of Scottish Government includes our judicial processes. So there are places where perhaps either we couldn't go, we might move not so swiftly to a court or tribunal adjudication, or there are places where processes could just be quicker, easier, better for people, and that would lighten the capacity burden on lawyers. And the last thing is that in some cases, legislative change directly impacts, increases or decreases the demand for our services. And here I would defer to Fiona, but for example, how housing solicitors have worked through the COVID-19 pandemic and in the return now to a higher level of actions is a really good example of an influence that government wields, whether or not the analysis around the impact of legal services happens at the time.
Do you want me to ask my other question very briefly, because it's just to Fiona McPhail?
Okay.
Fiona, the brief from Shelter talked about digital exclusion, and I represent a rural area, and obviously in rural areas broadband can be unreliable. I just wondered how individuals find, what the impact is of facing digital exclusion.
I shouldn't have said yes to you. I've made it my fault.
Do you want Pam to come in as well?
My challenge is that Pam DG's got another question on that. I wonder if we could hold that. Is that okay? Because I'm just concerned we're moving on. We're jumping, and Pam DG's got a question which is still on access to service. So can we go to Pam? That was my fault. Sorry.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Thanks for that, Chair. One of the areas I was keen to explore with you, and particularly yourself, Jen, given the focus of the work that you're doing with Inclusion Scotland around disabled people, 73% of respondents to a survey on the UNCRPD in 2021, the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Disabled People in 2021, said that deaf and disabled people find it hard to get the support if they have a legal problem. A quarter weren't sure. They're more likely to say they've experienced a civil law problem, but there are still barriers to getting advice, and they cited costs associated with reasonable adjustments not met by legal aid, to which I'll come to yourself, Colin, if that's all right in a minute. A lack of high quality BSL English interpreters in courts and in police stations, and that disabled people can often be exhausted, and I quote here, exhausted daily, so dealing with legal matters is mentally and physically impossible for many of us. So how do you think we could address some of that? Because those issues are the same issues that I remember writing a report about when I worked in the Independent Living in Scotland project in 2015. And so it feels like we've not made much progress on that. And I'm really excited to see the work that you guys are doing. But how do we tell more people about it, scale it up, resolve some of the issues I've just highlighted for disabled people?
Okay. Thank you, Pam, for raising that. And I can only echo what you have said, which is that this is an area where we are far behind. And we all aim to work intersectionally, but this is an area where the sort of the disproportionate inequality or the additional barriers have not been tackled as quickly, I think, in terms of ensuring that disabled people access legal advice and representation on equal footing. It is a reason why the Scottish Just Law Centre partnered with Inclusion Scotland several years ago, because this was identified in Scottish Government Equality Strategy as a gap in access to legal advice. And I would just say that myself and Heather Fiskin, as the leads on this project, remain frustrated with what we can do on a limited basis to address this gap. So the project is now, it is funded by Scottish Government's Equality and Human Rights Fund, but fundamentally we have sort of 1.5 solicitors, and what we can do with that is to focus on, as has been mentioned earlier, the strategic cases. So looking for cases from our partners that raise wider issues, for example, how local authorities exercise their discretion in reviewing PIP payments. This is something that has a widespread impact on people. We found the right case, we took the challenge, we try and publicise the result. But in this area in particular, in disability justice, I would say that referrals that we cannot take far outweigh our capacity to respond. And I agree, some of the responses are already known in the very good research work that have been done. Things around access to interpreters, but also actually on a wider basis, the legal sector's understanding of what good practice working with disabled people looks like. It's a piece of work that Inclusion Scotland has started, but again, we haven't had sufficient capacity to really roll that out. And alongside that, the legal sector's prioritisation, I think, of disabled people as service users to whom they have obligations. So the question was, what more can we do? And I think the answer comes back to, just as with the Scottish women's rights sector, it can't be just one or two specialist projects across Scotland that does this work. There needs to be a wider push across the legal sector for all law firms, basically, to work better. But also, there are probably some specific asks there that that should be pushed forward and that could make a real difference in the short term.
Thank you, Jen. I appreciate that. I could probably go on, and I won't take up too much more time on it because I know others have other questions, but maybe just to ask Colin about the issue around legal aid and using that to fund the reasonable adjustments that people might need.
Yeah, this is an issue that, well, I think we've discussed before. Yeah. and we've looked at over a period of time, and I suppose there are maybe two different categories of reasonable adjustments. There'll be adjustments that might be made in the delivery of the service to a particular client. And if that results in additional costs being incurred by a solicitor, whether that's costs that they incur, so outlays, or more time having to be spent on certain activities, then those can be accommodated within the legal aid system, and those would be considered as part of the general accounting that the solicitor would make in relation to their case. Now, it may be that there's... It may be that there's a lack of clarity about that. So, I mean, we're involved in a major project at the moment where we are clarifying our policies and practices in relation to all of our decision-making functions, and that includes accounts assessment or the approvals for additional costs being incurred. And as part of that process, we are already publishing, and we will work through everything to publish our statements of our policy and clear guidance to the profession, as well as the guidance that we provide for our own decision-making staff. And so that should clarify any areas of doubt that, that solicitors have about what they can and can't be paid for. And if they're in doubt, then they should contact us and we can advise them as they're dealing with the case. The other type of adjustment might be to the solicitor's own premises, for example, and those are things that, because of the funding model, we fund case by case. We can't make any, if you like, payments in relation to those kind of infrastructural adjustments that might make premises more accessible. That responsibility would lie on the service provider rather than us or them as a business, rather than us as a funder of the particular cases that they deal with. So I'm not sure which of those two groups was felt to be the bigger barrier, but obviously there's one that we can do something directly about and one less so.
I suspect both, if I'm honest, given the lack of maybe understanding of the profession about what additional costs might be and what they can apply for, and then there's probably an issue in terms of access to the services more generally. That may be something. I don't know if Jim from the Law Society, if you've heard of that.
Can Rachel? Rachel's been trying to come in for a bit.
Sorry.
I just wanted
to say briefly, I was really glad you brought up how exhausting it can be for people to try and find a lawyer to try and enforce their rights or to deal with councils or budget cuts or care package cuts. And I wanted to mention the way we deal with it, which is we've got a carers project which is set up with two carers centres, and I think that model has been really effective and really good at keeping that trust and that respect, because going, and I hear what you were saying, Colin, about being reactive and the adults with incapacity work being greatly increased in legal aid. But the way I think it could work really well for carers and people with disabled people is if you have a project which can deal with it holistically. So in the carers project that we do, it's a lot of adults with incapacity, but also challenging care packages. But what we've found is the very nature of how we work at a law centre, quite often people are dealing with housing issues. They're looking for adaptations to their house. They're looking at welfare rights appeals. Or cuts to care packages. And I just think it's such a holistic situation people can have. Mm-hmm. And if you're reacting to it by simply looking at a guardianship application, for example, you might be missing the rest of what is really affecting that family.
I appreciate that. Thank you. That's really, really helpful.
And I think, Jim...
I totally agree with Rachel. A holistic approach is probably the best way forward. When a client presents themselves at a law firm and they have various difficulties, and mental health difficulties and other difficulties, and the solicitor tries to deal with that. But this, because civil legal aid is so specialised now that generally there's a bit of signposting within a firm, it maybe causes some problems. It's something we'd have to look at. The Law Society do work with organisations to try and improve access to justice. There's a project with SOLD that the Law Society are doing, which is non-verbal communication, so a card approach to communicating with clients and doing work like that, and they continue with that work. But it'd be quite interesting to continue the conversation with Rachel, with the Law Society, to try and work out how we could maybe a more holistic approach to this. But we have to obviously go back to the situation, the shortage of solicitors in this field, which is probably, we have all these access to justice rights, and if everyone knew their rights, how are they going to access those rights if they don't have a voice within the court system or the criminal justice or the civil justice system?
Thank you. We'll now go back to the area that was raised earlier by Rachel Hamilton, but we'll go to Pam Gossel to reintroduce that area.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel, and thank you for your opening statements. I still feel that Rachel can ask the broadband question because mine doesn't cover that, but it does start that question off. Not everyone, as you know, has access to digital devices, especially in some of the poorest and deprived areas in Scotland. So given the shift after the pandemic, and obviously during the pandemic as well, to technology and digital services, I'd like to know what's been done to ensure that those face-to-face services still exist for those that really need it. And are they aware of them? And is the access to them quite easy? So I think I'd probably ask Gillian first, obviously, from the Citizen Advice Board, and then ask Fiona and anybody else that wants to come in.
Citizens Advice Network is multi-channel. The advice that we offer to clients, we think it's important that they engage with our services and advice provision in the way that best suits their needs. So we have our public advice site. If people want to self-serve digitally and feel able to do that, that is a good source of advice for people that wish to do that or perhaps just seek to understand an issue a bit more. But that face-to-face advice service is provided in the 59 CABs across the country. That obviously was challenging during the pandemic when that wasn't able to operate. We quickly pivoted to offer a helpline service, which people could phone a central number, and then now they are routed to that central number to their local bureau. So then if the first interaction is telephone even, they can then still get the face-to-face locally. which is the kind of basis of the network's advice provision in terms of that local essential community service. So we use digital assets to kind of augment our advice provision rather than direct people to digital as a first choice. We believe in channel choice for people, not channel shift. It should be up to the individual to decide how they wish to engage. If I could just briefly touch on, I suppose, virtual hearings and remote hearings used during the pandemic. We, you know, are still concerned and still hear from advisors across the network that the use of virtual hearings can disproportionately disadvantage party litigants, particularly those that are unrepresented. And those with additional support needs as well. So again, we feel this is about choice for the person that's engaging in legal proceedings to decide how to do that in a way that best suits their needs. We don't think it should be done on the basis of the type of proceeding or anything like that. We think it should be up to the individuals concerned as to how they wish to engage. And we think it's unrealistic to expect vulnerable groups to engage with virtual services without providing some additional one-to-one support. I suppose we've heard instances from across the network, and one in particular during the pandemic, where a client attended a virtual procedural hearing and the sheriff determined there was no jurisdiction and the case was dismissed and the client was unrepresented and didn't understand what was going on in those circumstances, and there's actually no sort of paperwork issued after that decision as well. And we do think the virtual nature of those proceedings at the time really compounded that situation for the client in terms of uncertainty and sort of understanding. So, as I said at the start, we'd certainly believe in channel choice and it's for the individual to decide how best to participate and engage with our advice services and also with legal proceedings.
Thank you, Fiona.
Thank you. Shelter Scotland also offers a multi-channel approach to the delivery of its advice, and we have expanded and developed the offer of digital advice. Now, for many people, that one-off advice through our website will help. It will provide the answers that they need, but particularly in the context of delivery of legal services, to come back to Rachel's question, we find that we do need either in-person or telephone-based advice. And we have... you know, throughout the pandemic, we found that we were able to continue delivering our services. And whilst we might not always be able to offer the face-to-face, I think particularly given the vulnerability of the clients we have, they prefer a telephone-based appointment than no appointment at all. But there's work to be done in this area. So I think the range, we can't... We have to recognise digital exclusion, and our own data at Shelter shows that most people accessing our website are doing so through mobile phone and not laptop. And so I think there's all sorts of issues that we need to continue to look at, and we absolutely need to make sure we're able to offer face-to-face and telephone-based services as well.
Can I come back on that after the broadband one? Yeah, is that okay? Or do you want?
Yeah. So Colin would be keen to answer, but okay. So if you're probing into the.
I've got something else for Colin as well.
Colin in first. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, convener. We've done some survey work just in the last sort of 6 to 9 months of clients who received assistance during the pandemic, either from private practice firms or from our own civil legal assistance office, which operates in Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Inverness. And one of the things we were wanting to explore was the accessibility of services and the experience of remote delivery. And generally speaking, there was a lot of satisfaction with remote models of delivery. We still offer, as I think most services would, face-to-face services, but what we've seen is people choosing to speak to us on the phone rather than coming in. So we still make appointments, but we get fewer no-shows now. So we had quite a lot of no-shows for face-to-face appointments, but we're making better contact with people more regularly as a result of doing more things by phone. And when we're covering a wide geographic area, then that is also obviously more convenient for either the solicitor adding to their capacity or for the client. So I think it's definitely got huge potential, but it can't be all or nothing. Because there will be some people or some cases or some issues for which it's not suitable. And Jen mentioned sort of trauma-informed practice, and there will be certain areas where you would want to see somebody face-to-face, absolutely. But we're seeing people exercising that choice where it's offered, and quite often that is to communicate by phone, by email, by text message, in a way that suits them and at a time that suits them. So it builds in flexibility, which I think is actually a real positive. Having said that, there's nothing particularly modern about the telephone. So it's a 20th century solution, rather 21st century solution, but it seems to be quite effective.
Yeah, thank you. Colin, just back to you. You spoke earlier on about the legal aid model being 70 years old and not fit for purpose for today. Obviously, we've got so much diversity in Scotland today, and I certainly think it's not fit for purpose myself, but and obviously I know people that have used it. But just the question on language barriers here, it would be good to hear from yourself, Colin, Fiona, and from Gillian, that do you face or do you see any language barriers to accessing advice or even the legal aid system today? Because obviously a 70-year-old system back there isn't fit for purpose today with the changes. But also from to Gillian's point of view, obviously the Citizens Advice Bureau being one of the largest advice services in Scotland, that do you see that any language barriers? And if not, what is it you provide to help people that can't speak English, and obviously to Fiona, but I'll start with you, Colin.
Okay, thank you. I suppose there's a range of different things there, and those who are more involved in direct client provision might be able to better talk about what they experience on a day-to-day basis and what they're able to provide. Again, I suppose it's similar to Pam Duncan Glancy's question in terms of what funding is available. So yes, we fund interpreting and translating services in relation to casework undertaken by solicitors. In terms of our services, then again, we will offer to translate materials if that's necessary. We've got a number of materials in standard, in some of our standard materials in different languages, and we've recently launched a customer communication support needs project where we will ask those who are contacting us, and most of the contact, I have to say, is through solicitors rather than directly with us, with applicants, but where applicants are contacting us, we'll check to see whether they've got any particular communication needs and whether that is language or otherwise. We can then make adjustments to ensure that they're able to get what they need from us. But as I say, it's probably more the kind of frontline services who are dealing with people on a face-to-face or on the phone basis who'd be able to answer that question more clearly.
Thank you, Colin. Gillian, do you have anything to add?
Thank you. I suppose, in general, when people are seeking advice face-to-face from our bureau, if there's a need for interpretation services or information in another language or format, that can be, made available so that that interaction can happen as and when. I suppose in terms of language as well, I know some of the national projects that we run, which again are funded differently to do certain things and perhaps serve a certain client group. There has been funding available to create some of those documents in additional languages as well, but I won't be able to comment further on the kind of details of that today.
Rachel would like to comment.
Sorry, just on that, Gillian, do you do any outreach work? Because obviously it's good to have things in obviously different languages, literature and things like that going out, but do you actually do any outreach to go into the communities to say that you have a service that it's available and people are aware of it?
Individual Citizens Advice Bureau in different bits of the country will run outreach services in different areas. So the majority will have a physical office location in one or more areas, but they may also do outreach to different parts of the country as well. Happy to come back with a bit more information on that if we provide written evidence after the session, if that's useful.
And Fiona would like, sorry, Rachel Moon would like to come in.
I just wanted to say from our perspective, I work in Govan Hill, which is one of the most diverse areas in Glasgow, and we use interpreters all the time, and we've got a lot of clients that don't speak English as a first language, and particularly they may have someone in their family that speak English as a first language or a second language and speak it well, but to be able to speak to that person with an interpreter and provide that dignity and respect, I think is really important. There's just two things I want to say about that. A community law centre model, having that physical space in a community for someone to come in, we found absolutely it's so important over COVID. Quite a lot of the housing associations around us were shut, the doors were closed, they'd nowhere else to go, and they would come in with letters to us. So we actually picked up quite a lot of cases we might not have seen before because of other services being closed. I think in terms of that as well, someone that doesn't speak English, having to upload a number of documents to email to send to us to look at frankly, is not going to work. So having that physical space to come into to do that is really important. But the second point I want to make is a pattern that we've been seeing over the last 6 months that we're looking to challenge is at the initial advice stage before it comes to us. So whether that's housing associations or the homeless casework team or the DWP, interpreters aren't being provided. And we are finding that they are being referred to us to get our interpreter. It can be something simple that should have been dealt with at that stage, but instead of getting an interpreter and dealing with it at that stage, they're referring it out, and it's simply, as it seems to us, because they don't want to get an interpreter, and we have the ability and the experience to get interpreters in place to do that.
Thank you.
Jen, you're nodding a lot. Are you wanting to come in?
Might as well just add something to what Rachel has said. Similarly to Rachel, for most of my career I worked in immigration and asylum, so all of our work on legal aid also required the use of interpreters. And I guess I would highlight, this is a question, this is sort of a follow-on to Pam. As you can be aware, one of the other issues is that the quality of interpretation is not, it's not regulated, basically, in Scotland. For some languages, it's easy to find an interpreter, but you do need interpreters who are competent at legal work, at court work, and so on. And for some communities, it's very, very difficult to find an interpreter or to find a suitable interpreter. So a client might, for example, have a reasonable request that an interpreter be female for an engagement, and again, to find a person at that time who will work on legal aid rates, because legal aid rates do slightly below for interpretation, market standard rates. Those can be barriers to providing legal advice. So we will have missed appointments, cancelled appointments, or an inability to support someone in the way they want to because of those kind of extra challenges. We're not here to talk about how to reform interpreting services in Scotland. I would suggest other models are available, and even on a citywide basis, for example, you see large organisations will commission a block contract to ensure an equality of access to high quality interpretation. And that's something that might ease the burden actually on small and medium sized legal aid firms and other places that need that that support.
I'm going to have to agree with you there, Jane, because I'm just going to quickly say this, I know we're going to move on. My mother, a couple of weeks ago, went to hospital, and my sister was there. My mother can fully understand English, but some broken shoe. When it comes to medication, my sister had to step in. She was asked not to speak, and an interpreter was brought in. That interpreter, my mum was going for a CT scan and some other scans. Quite serious that she physically can't move when she's in that under that equipment. And that person didn't give that key information passed to my mum. But my sister heard it, and my sister had to intervene to say. And then my mother-in-law was in the same hospital that day, and she had the same problem. So I know it's not for this committee, but regulation on interpreters is so important, because that was key decision, key information. And the actual interpreter turned around and said to my sister, "Oh, well, I don't think it was really important." Well, you're not there to say what's important. You're there to interpret it. So I know it's nothing to the committee, but I agree.
So, Pam. Yeah. Moving on, as we have to legal aid reform areas, Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, and good morning to everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning and for what you've said. We've touched on some issues of what you consider to be required in legal aid reform already, but I want to just explore some of them in a little bit more detail. We've talked about the need for different funding and delivery models, and Jim, you mentioned the need for an independent body to oversee some of this. I'm also struck that the review, the Evans review of 2018, it's 5 years old now, and you said, Jim, you said very little has moved since then. But in the discussion of that review, the review wasn't persuaded of a need to generally increase legal aid fees per se. Do you think that's because there's maybe a distinction between civil and criminal cases, and does the civil stuff get maybe left out a little bit in a way that criminal doesn't? What's your assessment of where that position of the review comes from?
Thank you, Maggie. I'm sure Colin will back me up on this. The criminal practitioners are probably far more vocal than the civil practitioners, right. And that may be why the things happened. The review 5 years ago went nowhere, because I think the difficulty was understanding the model, and what it was suggesting was dissecting law firms to find out how they finance themselves.
Right.
The difficulty the Law Society have had with this and the non-movement in this is the Legal Aid Board have so much information about each individual firm. You've heard Colin speak about the small firms, but there are obviously larger firms. They know how many grants of legal aid they've had in different sectors. They know what income they have. They probably know how many solicitors are there. They probably don't know what the rental of their property is. Right. They don't know what their backup staff is. I fully understand that. But money is not really the answer in relation to a lot of this. What we're looking at is how do we retain solicitors? And the Law Society have a difficulty in understanding how we retain these. Currently, we have training contracts at their highest levels. So we've got trainees coming into the profession at some of the highest levels we've seen for a number of years, but we're not seeing the retention of staff, of legal staff within the area we require in civil legal aid to become experts in that field and provide the access to justice that Scotland deserves. So that's the difficulty. So it's a broader problem than just money. The Law Society have been spending a lot of time and energy in relation to legal aid over the last 10 years, and it has been very difficult to progress it. I don't know what needs to be done now. I don't think we need another review because reviews have taken us nowhere. The difficulties, Colin has explained that the legislation is way out of date and the attempts have been made with the Legal Aid Board and the Law Society to move that on and move to maybe a different system, but that's not worked. But my major concern here is, fair enough, there is an opportunity of making more funding available, but we've got to look at the bigger problem. How do we retain staff?
Yep.
The staff, I work in a large firm in Edinburgh, which has 11 lawyers, some of them trainees, admittedly, but we have seen 20 trainees go through our system in the last 15 years, and less than 10% are staying within legal aid. They're going to public inquiries, they're going to the Scottish Government, they're going to private firms, or they're going to the prosecution service. How do we address that problem? And we are a firm who try to provide the best working environment. That's why we close down diaries, to make sure that our staff aren't overworked. But the problem is, it's a real lifestyle issue, and there is a major difficulty here, and I don't know really how we can address it unless we get all the parties around the table, including the court service, the Legal Aid Board and other users, to work out how we can do it. Even the Scottish Young Lawyers Association, and ask them, maybe they could help us. We engage with all these organisations, but we seem to always hit this barrier, maybe a year qualified, a 2 years qualified, that they want to move on to something else.
Thanks, Jim. Colin, I'll come to you in a moment. But can I just ask, should we consider legal aid a public service? Do you think that would help? If we had that as the framework within which we're working, bringing all of the different elements that you've just mentioned together in a more coherent way, would that help?
I think it would help. I think legal aid lawyers look upon themselves as providing a public service. And clearly, during the pandemic, they took the steps of going into courtrooms and putting themselves in difficult positions. They have helped with the backlog in the court service. They have provided useful steps at every stage during the pandemic of engaging, whether it was discussing whether jury's trial should continue. They've engaged in virtual courts. They've engaged with these things, and they provide a public service. And I think that is a fair recognition.
Okay. Thanks very much, Jim. Colin, the questions around the kind of, I suppose, the connection between delivery models and funding, where do you see us needing to go? And you mentioned the need for primary legislation in your opening remarks. Could you just unpick that a little bit more?
Okay, there are probably two or three different things in there. The first one, thanks to Jim for not taking us down a fees rabbit hole, because that could then just dominate the conversation. But on the back of the Evans review, the government established a payment panel, an expert panel on that. Gillian was involved in that, as was I, as were the society and the faculty. And on the back of that report, the government is now looking to commission some work to gather evidence about the financial position of the sector and to provide, a robust baseline for fees, because I think the issue that we've encountered and in our discussions over many years is that the rationale for any given level of fee has kind of been a little bit lost in the mists of time. Right. And therefore, I think we need to take a step back and base where we are now and moving forward. And I absolutely agree with Jim about the need for regular review on an ongoing basis. It's not good for the legitimacy of the system to not have reviews. But I think that needs to be evidence-based to start with, and then we can build from there. But more broadly, there's the fees question, which relates to how you pay for individual pieces of work or individual cases. And then there's a funding question, which is about how you support the service in general. And there are lots of different models for that that others have mentioned, and ways in which you could deliver that funding, whether that's, yes, through case by case, paying for individual posts, paying for a service through grant or commission or a contract, all of which would change the basis on which funding was provided and enable that funding to be directed at particular needs or particular services in particular places.
And just on that, what would, because one of the other sort of very striking things from the Evans Review was the need to shift to a more citizen-centred system. What would we need to do with our funding models and the funding landscape to achieve that citizen-centred approach?
I think at the moment, and what Martin Evans identified and what we absolutely agree with, is that the pattern of funding is not based on any assessment of need or priorities or outcomes that we're trying to achieve. It just responds. So it's that the money we spend, so this year it will be 130 odd million on services, is determined by individual acts of assistance provided by individual solicitors in firms up and down the country, and the decisions they make about which cases to take on or which cases they can't take on, and of course individuals' decisions to seek advice. But that's a complex process, and I think what we lack that clear understanding of the overall level of need and the outcomes that people are seeking, and where there is a gap between need, demand and supply. Yeah. And therefore that more interventionist model to try and respond to that, understand it in the first place, and then align funding with stated priorities and with outcomes in mind, rather than outcomes just arising by chance.
And I suppose that comes back to Fiona, your point around, you know, what if there were the right to legal representation for if you were about to lose your house? Is that the kind of sort of thing that we could draw into that sort of model of understanding that pulls
it's different exactly the sort of thing that the current system cannot provide. It doesn't provide entitlements. So there are schemes and there are eligibility tests, so you can be eligible, but you don't have an entitlement to any particular service. So, yes, decisions would have to be taken somewhere about where those priorities were, because, as we've heard, there are lots of competing demands. So ultimately, resources are going to be finite and choices will have to be made somewhere along the line. But if a decision is taken that, yes, housing advice for those who are at risk of eviction is an essential and must be provided, then you need to have mechanisms to make that
to do so, that, to make that happen.
Rather than hoping that it happens.
Thank you, that's helpful. Jane, I'm wondering if I could bring you in for your comments on the kind of standardisation or the inclusion of a right to legal representation along the lines that Colin has been describing there. What would that require, or how would that change us having to think about legal aid in the way that we from the way we currently do?
Thank you very much, Maggie, for that question. And I guess I would start by saying that I agree with the last part of Colin's description of the change that needs to happen. So this needs to be a wider discussion beyond how SLAB works or what the Scottish Legal Advice Board budget looks like. And I'm just aware as well that sort of there was a nod to Fiona. And I guess I would say I would invite Fiona to comment after if she wishes. But I think that one approach could be, as you've pointed out, treating legal aid as a public service and looking at a right to a certain level of advocacy, legal advice or legal representation in relation to certain decisions or in relation to certain sort of life situations. So you can assume that in many of the cases in which Shelter acts, people would be facing an issue that we would want to prioritise. But it's not meaningful to have a right to respond or a right to request review of a government decision without actually the support and legal advice that you need. I think other areas we could look at, some of them arise from UK government processes and not Scottish government processes, but I think that the work around benefits, as well as some of the work that debt advisors do, that actually start to exceed the levels of that start to exceed the levels of competence in terms of needing legal advice and representation, but that not being available. Those are areas, they're social justice areas, where we could examine how that's currently being provided and whether we could provide a guarantee across Scotland of an equal level of service. It would be like a health service kind of response to particular issues.
Okay. Thanks, Jen. That's helpful. Fiona, I've referenced you a few times. Do you want to come in? And then I've got one final question.
I'll keep it brief in the interest of time. Thank you very much, Maggie. But yes, legal aid as a public service, absolutely, I think, is the way that we want to start thinking access to justice as a fundamental right. I will offer to come back to the committee further because there was research conducted a number of years ago, and I'm trying to remember when, but about, you know, for every £1 spent on legal aid, there's X amount, £10 saved. Yeah. And Housing Shelter recently published evidence on the cost of eviction. We're talking around 15,000, if not more, costs for an eviction, which is normally you know, worth less in debt of that. So I think there's something here just about taking a step back from the issues and analysing it differently. And obviously I'm focusing on housing, but there are many, many aspects that we need to revisit. Why is access to justice not as important as access to healthcare? Why don't we recognise the importance of intervening at that early stage? And we do it in the context of criminal, with good reason. But is this an opportunity to look at, particularly with the Human Rights Bill coming down, the wider socioeconomic rights? So I'll leave it there. I'll offer to come back with further evidence.
That's really helpful. Thank you. And I mean, I think that question is a big question for us to consider, but really, really important. My final question, if I may. Rachel, in your opening comments, you said, thinking about the strategic work that we need to do around legal aid, we need to move the boundaries of equalities law. Can you? I was struck by that, and I'm just curious to know a little bit more about what you mean.
Well, when I mentioned earlier about working for the Carers Project, and we do a lot of work with the Carers Centre, and that level of trust means that we get a lot of cases brought to us for guardianships or normal adults in capacity work, but it also means that we speak to the clients about other issues that might be going on. Right. So we've got a wide cache of clients that we speak to that we can then get a sense of patterns of injustice or patterns of where discrimination is lying. And it's meant that we've been able to look at something in particular, like cuts to care packages or deductions from care packages. Then we can then use equalities law to try and, there's not much equalities at cases in the courts, and if we can then try and use strategic litigation to move the boundaries on something, then that will hopefully start to progress equalities law more generally.
Okay, no, so that's interesting. I mean, in some ways it ties up to Fiona's last point about looking at rights in the round and making sure that we are linking into the expectations that all citizens should have of what they can expect from services, from whether that's a legal service or any other public service. So, yeah, thank you. I could go on, but I probably shouldn't.
Okay.
Thanks, Jo.
Keen to now go to Karen to cover the topic which Fulton introduced almost at the start of the meeting. So, Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener, and I'm sure Fulton will be able to come in with his other hat on in regards to Justice Committee. And since I became an MSP, I've had a few constituents approach me in regards to their concern that the court system was being used to abuse them further in regards to abusive relationships, whether that was physical, domestic violence or coercive control in relationships. And it's ranged from one partner receiving legal aid and financially draining another partner. There's been, looking into this and reading a bit more about this, we're seeing There are ex-partners who have been able to cross-examine partners who they have abused, who they've perhaps even had restraining orders against them, and that has been allowed to happen within the court system. And it just seems to be, again, it's disproportionately women that are affected by this. And I'm wondering if this is something that you're aware of, that you're attuned to, and what can be done about it. I'm wondering, Jen, you were nodding there, so I'll pick on you first.
Oh no, that will teach me to nod. So the Scottish Women's Rights Centre works in the area of civil cases only, so civil justice only. But one of the issues that they've looked at and occasionally made comment on for a long time is the kind of poor coordination between the civil and the criminal justice systems for women who are fleeing gender-based violence, mm-hmm. And also trying to identify areas in our justice system or our laws that lead to situations that you have suggested. So the use of a process that's open to anyone, but in a way that appears to be abusive and in a way which actually courts are unable to address. What I would say is that I am also on the Women's Justice Leadership Panel, which is about to conclude kind of a year-long survey of some key issues around the experience of women across the justice system. I think that what's needed here is a kind of an individual issue-by-issue analysis of kind of pragmatic changes that we can make, because I think our observation across the piece is what you said is right, and we do see that in our practice, but there's a careful balancing act in terms of ensuring that the process doesn't change because someone has used it abusively, but that the process does change so that our systems of justice can't be a mechanism in this way. I will add, because we're here, that there are barriers in accessing legal advice through the legal aid system for women as well, surviving violence, and that's something that we've raised and could raise again. But there are perhaps some areas where, for specific types of actions, the rules should be changed slightly, because fundamentally, what you're asking a woman to do is to defend with her own money or her family's money a matter that basically is in the public interest, even though it falls on the civil side, even though it impacts on herself and her family. So I'll add that as well. That could be one of those systemic changes, and again, that broader access to justice focus, and actually what we aspire to as a community should be maybe a more key element in how we evaluate legal aid that's available for people.
Really helpful. Thank you. Anyone else want to come in on this?
Was there anybody else wanting to come in on that kind of area? No. So, Pam, were you wanting to comment?
Thank you, Convener. Just still on, obviously, the subject of domestic abuse. Oftentimes, obviously, women who are fleeing domestic abuse, and as it's been mentioned today in the committee, they're temporarily homeless and are often without access to finances. And it's sometimes the case that their abusive partner controls the finances. The third sector is really good at supporting mechanisms for these women. But at times, when they're either trying to access advice and services, for example, in private, without their partner knowing, what barriers currently exist and how can we remove them to have basically the advice system to help them more, and obviously the courts as well. So I think it's quite open to anybody answering this one.
I'm happy to come in on that. The we've got a women's project that goes into the Simon community in town in Glasgow, and that project has been really successful, I think, because it's run by two female solicitors, but we also have a lived experience caseworker that was brought in under a project as a soft advice in terms of speaking to a lawyer, applying for legal aid, asking lots of questions, trying to get the details, challenging whatever housing decision that needs challenged. But the lived experienced woman can provide such different level of advice and assistance than a traditional legal relationship can, and that's something that certainly Govan Law Centre are looking at pursuing in different funding applications going forward, that sort of bridge between the solicitor and the client and the kind of technical questions we have to ask and the other questions that they may be more comfortable asking someone in a, from a different perspective. Okay.
Anybody else?
I mean, we have regrettably had clients and cases where the woman has, in the context of homelessness, is not able to get out or access those services. Our primary concern is making sure she has a safe space and somewhere private and confidential to get the legal advice. So I think, I mean, this goes back to the fundamental point that, that Shelter Scotland is saying, we need to make sure our homeless services are adequately resourced. No woman fleeing domestic violence should have to, you know, hide, you know, but go back to the abuser, let alone, you know, sleep in her car to access the legal advice that she needs to get before accessing that statutory service. So we do, and that is something I have to say, that we have come up against women who are not able to, and we have real concerns about making sure they have the space to not just get the one-off advice, but they're able to engage with us, that they're not in an abusive environment.
Just, I've got one more question. It's quite open. I've got a few cases.
Is it on the same area?
Yes, it's on the same area, kind of. But I've got a few cases talking about the financial side. So basically, and more times, it's the woman that basically doesn't have that kind of cushion of finances, and they're out their home. So, and then there's that obviously domestic abuse, criminal side going on. There's a broken bridge between a civil case and a criminal case, we're finding, that one doesn't talk to the other to what's happening. So both cases are taken separately. Is that something that people have dealt with? Or because, like I said, the case that I'm dealing with right now, the lady has basically come forward and her finances have all stopped, but she's in a kind of civil case in courts on that one. But then obviously the criminal side is a domestic abuse, the actual obviously hurting the woman. And it's just not joining up. And there's quite a few that have come back to me to talk about that, that both different. So is there anything that...
So, yeah, so if we can go to Fulton first, because that was the area he was
wanting
to...
Fulton.
No, it's fine, it all feeds in, but if we get from Fulton first, then we can then get folk to come in.
Aye, thanks, Convener. No, I just tried to catch the Convener's eye there, Pam, because my question might supplement yours, and then they can sort of be answered together. In my other committee role, I sit in the Justice Committee, and last week we'd done a wee bit of post-legislative scrutiny work around the domestic abuse bill that was passed in 2018 in the last parliamentary session, and obviously that was around about coercive control and criminalising that. So I wanted to ask how that is overlapping with some of the work you do around domestic abuse, and you know, moving on from Karen's point and Pam's question about if you're seeing any overlap between coercive control now being more recognised as a form of abuse, and then that getting into the civil courts as well. I wonder if there is any thoughts on if there's been overlap there, if you've picked up on that in your work, and hopefully that helps to supplement Pam's direct question, which has got a specific case she's referring to.
So we're wrapping up quite a lot of things in this, which is good. Gillian, do you want to, you don't need to, there's a lot there, so just answer whichever bits you want and we'll see who else wants to come in after.
We do have queries that come to us related to advice on domestic abuse. Our public advice site has the quick close function on those pages, so anyone that is accessing that advice digitally can quickly close that down if someone else was in the vicinity and could see that on the screen. In terms of the point about the justice system and the courts on this issue, I suppose it's not so much the courts issue, but we have seen, I suppose it comes back to the legal aid and the access to practitioners element in terms of, you know, a client, we've had occasion of a client, their ex-partner has pled guilty to charges of domestic abuse, and she's then trying to sort of evict the individual and children from the home, and just the inability to sort of seek a legal aid practitioner that will take on that case or on that individual. And again, that comes back to the point about should there be other considerations, you know, when somebody in that situation, for example, is trying to find a practitioner to act in those circumstances.
Thanks. Anybody else want to come in on this area?
There is an overlap, clearly. A lot of cases, I'm a criminal practitioner actually, so there's an overlap generally with civil cases, So, Pam, we do get that overlap, and it's quite interesting because there's a case the law has changed in the criminal law that where a party wants to recover the complainant's medical records, she has a right to be heard now in the criminal courts. And that's a big overlap because that's a power that's now been used, and with the legislation coming on, that there will be more powers. I don't know if they're all reflected in the civil courts, and I think that that's something that's being looked at. So, for instance, you've had the Dorian Review, which looked at the methods of giving evidence, whether it's behind a screen or pre-recorded evidence and stuff like that. And I think that is being looked at to bring into the civil field, which will give further protections, which there are there, and there is work being done on bringing them into the civil field, if that assists.
Just very quickly, I think the point raised by Pam about the disconnect between civil and criminal justice systems is definitely something that is a live issue in probably most of the legal casework that we run through the Scottish Women's Rights Centre. And what I would say is I'm sure that the Women's Justice Leadership Panel is due to report at the end of March, and there is most likely going to be a chapter on the evidence that was taken and some of the recommendations, so that could be something to look at for those of you who are interested in that issue. In relation to coercive control, those reforms were supported by the Women's Rights Centre, and that is an issue that we continue to see. And I'm relatively sure that our evidence was that this is a start, but that there's still a good deal of work around an understanding of that crime, as well as really what we're still asking, the kind of evidence we're still asking people to bring in order to effectively make out the crime. So I think our position was that it's a step forward, but that alone is never going to be the solution. I think that wider initiatives like raising awareness of economic abuse with banks, for example, are other areas where we can work effectively to kind of spread the net rather than just create a better remedy, if that makes sense for people. And the very, very last thing, Pam, in terms of what else we can do, and what other barriers there are, is just a reminder that we need to work intersectionally. So what you raised earlier, so barriers for people for whom English is not a first language, barriers for disabled women accessing those services and legal advice. I think Inclusion Scotland did a really good piece around the double barriers for disabled women surviving gender-based violence. And the last thing is just to remember that also people face barriers because of their migration status. So we had this evidence throughout COVID-19 and the cost of living crisis. But being NRPF is itself an additional factor that would make you more vulnerable to exploitation and abuse, but also less able to access legal advice.
Yeah. Thank you. Rachel, can I just check, did you get the answer you needed around the broadband?
Well, I did, in a kind of a broad sense, broadband sense, perhaps. It's fine. I can leave it. I think I've made my point, and if I need to, I can follow it up.
Thanks. Maggie.
Thanks, Joe, for indulging me. I remembered, Colin, that you'd said, I think, in your opening remarks that legal aid should be there to solve problems and to support people to solve problems, not become a specialist area in itself. Can you just elaborate on that? Because I think that's actually quite an interesting, given actually the conversation we've just had around the specialisms required for dealing with certain legal aid cases. Just curious in your views.
It's a complex system. So the legislation is complex, the regulations run to, well, I don't know how many hundred pages, the guidance that's associated with that is fairly intensive as well. So I mentioned the project where we're trying to clarify all our guidance, but what we're trying to clarify is a perhaps overly complex system. So it'd be preferable if the system itself were simpler. There are lots of nooks and crannies in the system that practitioners need to be aware of, or their clients need to be aware of, whether that's in financial assessment or the particular permissions that are required to take certain steps, or in the billing for work. And if you're not fully aware of that, then there are tripwires that you can fall over, which can result in it taking longer to get legal aid, or not work not being done, or work not being paid for. that's been done because the proper processes weren't followed. Okay. So that's really what I'm getting at, is if we can streamline and simplify that process, it makes it more understandable to people so they can maybe get a clearer idea of whether they are likely to qualify, because that's complex in itself, and if so, what the process is, what information is needed, so that that can be done first time rather than after multiple interactions, because we do find some people drop out of the system while we are in the process of making a decision, just because we have to go back and forward so often. So a simpler, more streamlined system should be more accessible, and more people should know that they can access it.
So better for everybody.
Absolutely.
Thanks. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much, everyone. That's been a really interesting session. We've, I think, covered all of the areas that we were hoping to touch on. There's obviously lots for us to consider as we take our work in this area forward. But that concludes the formal part of business for today. So we'll now move into private to consider the evidence that we've heard. Thank you.